Hi everybody, this is Liam Martin from Running Remote, and in this video, we're gonna be talking about what are the six things that make remote workers good at their job. Not all remote workers are created equal. Some are actually really badly suited towards remote work, and some are fantastically suited towards remote work. And if you're just working inside of an office, the actual difference is quite surprising. So first off, the very first thing that you actually have to look out for counterintuitively that makes a remote worker good at their job is introversion. Now, listen, I know that everyone wants like a charismatic leader that runs their companies or manages their employees, but in reality, actually, introverted individuals, at least from what we've seen, have had a longer, effectively lifetime value with an employer, and that employer has been really happy with their work. Remote work is fundamentally more lonely than an office environment. So to be able to overcome that, a lot of people that don't necessarily like a whole bunch of people work really well in remote work environments. And this is somewhat counterintuitive for a lot of people that are thinking, oh, I want to hire a people person. No, actually, you don't want to hire a people person. You want to be able to hire someone that can be really, really focused on deep, long-term work. That's what's important. Forget about the people person. They generally only work really well for sales, and I would probably say high-level management. Second thing that I look for when I'm looking for remote workers is this old saying that I use quite a bit with a lot of the employees that I work for, which is, don't ask me what to do, tell me what you did. Another way of talking about this is ask for forgiveness instead of permission. The ability to be able to think independently and actually make a decision inside of the business without actually talking to me or waiting for me to be able to give you permission to make a decision is not the type of people that you want inside of a remote first company. Now, if you're dealing with a lot of procedures and processes and all that kind of stuff, like if you're running a nuclear reactor, of course you need to actually wait for permission before actually doing something. But if you work in a tech startup or if you work in an agency or anything like that, you really fundamentally can't break anything inside of the business for at least 24 hours. Any decision that you make in the business can usually be fixed within 24 hours. And usually you'll be able to get that type of feedback pretty darn quick. So don't ask me what to do. Tell me what you did. The next one is critical thinking and managing fires in sequence. Now, this is also a little bit of a difficult one to be able to take into consideration. You have to deal with a heightened level of stress and be able to actually deal with explosions going off all around you and figure out which ones are the most critical in that particular time that you're inside of the business. So as an example, let's say that we have the server go down, but then we also have 1,000 customer support tickets. Which one do you address first? The customer support tickets or the servers being down? Ideally, actually, if you can solve the server problem in 5 minutes, go for the server problem. If it's gonna take 20 hours, then you actually need to solve those tickets right now, because the actual server being down for 20 hours is gonna result in a whole bunch of people quitting your product or service way faster than you have the time to be able to fix the server. So you need to be able to think critically about that, think independently about that. Remember, tell me what you did, don't ask me what to do. And then you can actually address a lot of those fires in sequence and hopefully solve all of the company's problems, particularly when you're in heightened states of stress, like servers going down or denial of service attack on our system. The next one is trust, and trust is a two-way street. So the employer needs to trust the employee and the employee needs to trust the employers. I have a concept that I like to call radical transparency that we use quite a bit inside of the company, which is whatever we can make public internally, we do. So how much time do you spend working on projects? What do those projects look like? What are the debates around those projects? What are the outputs from those projects? All that information should be available to as many people as humanly possible so that everyone can then think like an owner and then can deploy real critical thinking inside of the business. And this is not available in the vast majority of on-premise companies that I've encountered, because that documentation, number one, is not there. But then also secondarily, there's a lot of closed doors. There's a lot of those like secret meetings that are happening. You should get rid of all of those meetings. Be as open as humanly possible inside of your company so that everyone inside of the company can be able to have equal access to that information.
generation.
Next, you need a strong support system. And what I mean by that is, let me give you a story. We had someone that worked for us a few years ago, and they actually ended up leaving our company for a lower cost position. And whenever that happens, it's usually a pretty big red flag, and HR basically was like, hey, this guy's leaving for less money. What the heck is up with that? Well, we ended up talking to him, and he ended up having a death in his family, and his girlfriend of the last few years had left him literally within the same month, and he was completely alone in his house. And he got pretty lonely inside of that house all on his own. And what he wanted to do is, he got a really good offer from a few friends of his to be able to work inside of an office long term, and he took the opportunity because he just needed that type of human interaction. So it's really important that you have a strong support system from, you know, from family, from social environments, that kind of stuff, so that when you're working from home or you're working remotely, you can get that box checked inside of your own personal hierarchy of needs. Last one, you are egoless. And I know that that sounds weird coming from a guy that's talking to you on YouTube and making a whole bunch of YouTube videos. It would sound somewhat counterproductive. However, fundamentally, what you really have to do is, you have to say to yourself, all right, am I actually critical to this business's operations? If I am, I need to be able to remove myself from being critical to the business's operations as much as humanly possible. What more can I do to be able to make myself redundant inside of the company so that I can, number one, if something happens to me, the company will be completely fine. But then number two, I can actually work on much more difficult and interesting problems as opposed to the somewhat boring problems that I'm doing now, but I'm only doing them because I'm absolutely critical to the business. That's what I mean when I'm talking about egoless. You need to be able to look for that inside of your organization. I hope that was helpful to you. If it is, please like and subscribe to this video down below. It really helps out the algorithm quite a bit. And if you are really interested in learning more about actually how to find remote employees, we actually have some fantastic videos about that should probably be floating around me right on my head right now. I'll see you later.